damaging India. Brought to you by Raymond for the special occasion called Life, ICICI Group, safer, simpler, smarter, and Ernst & Young from start to finish.
Perhaps the best way to fight a turning economy is to keep fit. This is how Pradeep Kar, founder and chairman of the 1.5 billion rupee Michelin Group, starts off his average day with some strenuous exercise and a quick run. The routine has remained much the same all these years. But the enterprise Kar began a decade ago as a networking solutions company with 2 million rupees borrowed largely from friends and relatives has come a long way. It has been a tale of forcing opportunities and grabbing them before competition. Today, the Microlin Group comprises internet-centric companies, offering web and internet media services. Perhaps the most popular of them all is India.com, a youth website which Kar launched in one of the biggest flashbang operations in the dot-com boom time. So how does it feel to have been a dot-com entrepreneur? And how is the man, considered by many as an industry pioneer, managing the corporation, the people, and the tribulations of the new economy? We find out.
Hello and welcome to Managing India. Today we are in conversation with Microlin Group founder and chairman Pradeep Kar in the city of Bangalore. Pradeep, welcome to Managing India.
Thank you very much.
Are you getting sleepless nights watching the Nasdaq sink and Dow Jones following with it? The Indian market's not far behind. Technology spend going down.
No, I think the entire issues about the environment and all this stuff that's happening around, the only concern I have is what would the impact of that be in the economy, and therefore the fallout of that in terms of the Indian industry, and therefore in our efforts to build our international business. Certainly the element of concern and caution.
Right. But I'm sure you've seen some of these situations come before you in the past. How have you handled them? And number one. Number two, how do you carry employees? I mean, now you have far more employees than you perhaps had when you were a simple networking company 10 years ago. And I guess employees were used to more better salaries, better way, better quality of life, working with dot-coms. How do you manage a situation like that?
I think there are two elements, I think unfortunately, and I would say fortunately, we're not listed. Since we're not listed, we have not seen a stock go up, nor have we seen it come down. And therefore, from that extent, employees have not seen their value in their stock options
appreciate
overnight. As well as depreciate. I think the essence is that, there's a reality in what's happening. As India gets integrated into the global economy, and as people's expectations of creating wealth through stock options start emerging, the reality that sets in is that those jobs that started and increased dramatically can also get cut based on the economic downturn. And if you look at the US today, in the day that Cisco and Intel defined that they expect slower growth in the current financial year, immediately the next line that says X number of jobs to go. That will also start happening here, and the Indian employee will start realizing that that's part of the new culture of this industry.
But even taking them through a situation like this, it must be a challenge, clearly, especially for a company like yours, which has grown so fast. Do you communicate regularly with employees at times like this? How do you keep them in confidence? Because at the end of the day, you also said that, you're not a listed company. So while there is no upside, there is no downside. Maybe employees want to be in the secure, comfortable listed company, which is seen as larger and more ambitious.
I think there are two elements that, when Cisco decides, for example, that they cut 5,000 jobs, it's not that Cisco's bank balance is low and therefore they need to cut it. It's more in the sense that
looking at the future and
does the growth necessitate so many people to be in the organization? And therefore, from an Indian standpoint, as long as people don't lose jobs based on that element, I think it's okay. But there's a reality that sets in, and therefore you define and communicate with the people to say, hey, the market may not be as large as we anticipated. Therefore, it may have some elements in the projections that we made, and therefore some elements in the cost structures of the companies. And therefore, compensation, which normally may have increased quarter on quarter, we'll say once in 6 months or once in a year now. So some reality will check in there.
Yeah. But are you saying people are down the line are clearly conversant with the realities, outside?
Yeah, because, the people down the line also have friends in other companies. And, if you're an isolated company that is feeling a downturn, then certainly you have a larger issue. But if the entire industry is going through this, and they talk to their friends, and they say, hey, we have the same issues in our organization, I think everyone is in sync with reality.
You've been largely kind of growing in a linear fashion for many years that I remember, and in the networking space and in the infrastructure space, networking infrastructure space. And I would imagine that a lot of new ventures that came in really came in the last 2 years. And especially, you know, you have your .com properties, India, INDYA.com, ITSpace.com, Microland.net, and, you know, I mean, all those businesses. Any regrets about having really, you know, used those last 2 years as a launch pad to expand and so fast?
If you look at, you know, last 2 years has been a very significant transition year, you know, till 98, if you reflect back, since 89 when we were formed, till 98, we were to a large extent a networking services company. More so, we were very much hardware driven, which means close to 85% of our revenues came from selling hardware products. It's not conventional PCs, but the Ciscos and the routers and the switches of the world. And if I reflect back to say, you know, what did we achieve in the last 2 years? One, we moved from a pure hardware-centric company to a pure services company. Second, we moved from a domestic-centric company to an international-centric company. Third, we moved from pure technology services to an internet-centric company. And fourth, we also were lucky that we were able to be in the media space by launching of the dot-com stuff. Reflecting back, I guess, you know, there's certainly an element of satisfaction that we were one of the few companies, and the answer is few, that managed the transition from a hardware-centric into a newer space. Having said that, you know, today we're divided in two clusters. One is infrastructure services. We have Planet Asia, and that started in November 97. And we have 620 people
Internet
there.
Internet solutions company.
Yeah, Internet professional services. Now we have 620 people there in Planet Asia. We launched in July this year a high-end networking software company called NetBrahma. And Microland.net is to a large extent a networking services part of what we did. And the fourth, we are also into education, and we are relaunching that sometime soon as a technology e-learning company. The opportunity came in the dot-com space. And you know, when you reflect back, and if you were entrepreneurial in 99, you know, the entire buzz was, you know, if you're not on the dot-com space, you're not in the internet at all. So there was a big temptation that happened to say, hey, I think we know what it takes to build that company. I think we understand the underlying technologies and the underlying offerings. And then we took a conscious call, which is, which would be a better, bigger risk for us, to be in that space or not be in the space. And the decision we took was to not be in the space was a bigger risk in 99. Okay. It's different in April, the market turned. And then when we said that when we get into the dot-com space, we said, what should we do? We started on the easy play, which is the technology industry. So we did a small initiative as ID Space. And then again, you know, we thought, if you want to be in the space, be in mainstream. And we launched India, indywire.com. I guess we're lucky and we'll survive because we did one smart thing. We raised large amounts of capital pre-NASDAQ fall. And therefore, from a staying power, et cetera, we have, you know, significant staying power going forward. And also in India, for example, News Corp is the largest investor. And now if we integrate and synergize with News Corp's other properties, I think we have a strong story that you'll see unfolding in the current financial year.
Right. But one of the questions I really wanted to ask you, Pradeep, is while your core business, where you really built your strengths, networking solutions, hardware, it did have potential, and it perhaps does still have potential today as much as ever before. Any regrets? Because clearly management time is being spent in the new businesses, and I'll let you answer that in a slightly more expansive format. That's after this short commercial break. Stay with us. Welcome back to Managing India. We're still in conversation with Microland Group Chairman Pradeep Kar. One of my questions was, maybe I said it in a slightly roundabout way. Now, the dot-com space clearly took up a lot of management time, even if the other businesses, which is your core networking business, was growing at the same time. Now, any regrets there? I mean, that you've not spent enough management time, or are you confident that you've given both your best, and even if the dot-com space slows down, the other one will continue to grow?
No, I think if you look at, you know, leave us at the dot-com space, and if you look at 2 years ago, we were not into software. We were, you know, our international revenues was close to zero. Today, if we reflect back, out of 1,700 people that we have, over 1,000 people are involved in international operations. And that's on one cut. And you know, we have two entities focused on the software space. In the networking hardware space, yes, there was potential. But going forward, we felt like that the margins that this industry commanded, or the hardware industry commanded, would not be very profitable to spend too much management bandwidth. And so forth, India.com, etc. happened. But going forward, you'll see this financial year, you know, the 01-02, will be a fairly large player back in the networking services this year. And if the emphasis is for this year.
Right. But if you were to do something differently, I mean, you cut back to 1999, what would you have done differently?
It's difficult, you know, what would I have done differently? I probably would have raised a little more money in 2-3 of my businesses, and that point of time, there were lots more people sitting outside saying, hey, take some money from me. We raised last year, to give you an indication, close to just under $80 million of equity last year. I probably would have raised some more money. That's one thing. Second, I don't think I would have not got into the dot-com space, because two things happened in the space. It profiled the group clearly in the consumer's mind and in the broad-based people's mind.
And that's where you were headed personally. I mean, as a founder, that's where you wanted to go.
Yeah, no, I think the essence is the following. India.com helped position and leverage the group. And having said that, you know, we leveraged India.com significantly, going back to customers to say, we know what it takes to build an e-business online 24/7 business. And you trust us, we can run your business well. Because Planet Asia was involved in building the solution. Micro Networking manages the infrastructure. So there are enough issues and experiences that I think will be invaluable in the other parts of our business.
Right. Now, to come back. So you said one of the things you would have clearly done differently is brought in more money.
Yes.
And what would you have done with that money? Or is it only because it would have helped you stay on longer?
No, in India.com, for example, you know, we raised over $55 million. We still have large numbers in the bank. I'm just saying, within the entire context, we probably would have scaled up operations in other parts of the business faster.
What would those have been?
Our education and networking services.
Is that because the way you look at the market today, you don't see that kind of potential?
No, I don't see that. I think the essence is finally, you know, which you rightly said, given the set of time that you have, the management can do as much as it can. And if you reflect back in what we have tried to do in the last 12 months, very few companies did so many things parallelly. We launched a networking software company in yesterday's paper. If you saw, you know, JP Morgan Partners made an investment there within last 1 year. We launched India.com, which is less than a year old. We launched IT Space, which is less than a year old. We launched Jupiter Research. We launched Internet World. All, if you looked at the number of things we did, was significant. Besides, we grew our software business into Planet Asia, which did revenues in the year ending March 2000 of $2.5 million. Dollars. This year it's close at 14 million. We grew that business also 6.5-7 times.
But is that likely to sustain the next year?
It won't grow 6-7 times because the base was small, but certainly we hope that we'll be close to doubling next year. Again, the base is small, but we think we can do that.
But I mean, for instance, again, one criticism could be purely as a business, if someone were to look at your business model, sudden expansion into too many businesses, looking at so many things at one time. Were you conscious of this? I mean, that it might be seen as a problem issue, though you're not a listed company, but there would be issues of investors who in any case hold large chunks of your companies, and they're putting pressure. Though I'll come to that later.
No, I think if you look at where we are, the investors we've gotten, except I'll leave us a News Corp, are existing investors. So if you look at again...
And you've got Chase, you've got GE.
Yeah, Chase invested in Planet Asia, they invested in Microland, they invested in NetBrahma. If you look at ICICI, they invested in Microland in 89, invested in Planet Asia, invested in December 99, right now Microland, invested in IT Space. So the reality is we did not have to go outside existing investors to raise money. And that's the best part of a relationship with the investors.
But you've been more of an entrepreneur than anything else. I mean, that's the perception the world at large holds. Now, facing investors of this size and might, when you say News Corp, you say GE, Chase, and all of them sitting on your board, I mean, how does it feel? I mean, do you really have that freedom to do what you want anymore?
I think, the first element is that as long as your objectives and the investors' objectives are aligned, which means maximize share value, build a great business which can be sustained over periods of time, I don't see an issue. If you have different objectives and they conflict, then you have a lot of issues. But in my mind, we have single objective, build great companies and maximize share value.
Right. We'll talk a little more about life of the organization, what lies ahead, but that's after this short commercial break. So stay with us. But Welcome back to Managing India with me, Govind Rajyathiraj. We're still in conversation with Pradeep Kar, chairman of the Microland Group in Bangalore. Pradeep, how do you motivate people personally?
I guess, you know, there's a simple philosophy that one has, that, you know, why do people want to work for you or work for an organization? They want to learn something, they want to have some fun, and they want to earn something. And as long as, you know, they are all three dimensions that you're conscious of, and if you add a fourth dimension to say that, give them adequate freedom and give them, quote unquote, a mountain to climb, there's a high probability then they will climb the mountain and have a lot of fun in the way. So that's it.
But in your organization, I mean, I'm sure an employee of indya.com, that's india.com, has more fun than perhaps the chap who's really putting cables and linking computers together. So is that a kind of, do you notice that disparity?
I think that the essence is the following. First, different businesses have different cultures. Okay, the culture in india.com, and starting from the office decor, etc., is very different from the culture in a networking services business. The profiles of people that join that business have come with a perspective and a background and experience culture which is different. So they come back. I think the essence is, no matter who's doing what in various parts of the business, as long as he's enjoying himself, he's learning a lot, he's having great fun and earning some money, I think that's fine.
And how do you motivate people and hold them together in a downturn, the beginning of which we're seeing now?
No, I've gone through a couple of downturns.
You were just telling me in the break that you're a seasoned entrepreneur, therefore you don't want to be viewed like any other first-generation dot-com entrepreneur.
No, I don't. I mean, I don't mind being viewed in any which way, but I'm just saying, you know, I'm a fairly seasoned entrepreneur because I've been doing this for the last 11 years. I think the essence is very simple, you know, and we've been fairly lucky that a core team that worked with us since 89 is still there. My belief is very simple. It's rarely people will leave you for more money. It's rarely people will leave you when you're going through a downturn. In fact, good people will stay with you when you're going through a downturn because they know that you need them more and the organization needs them more. They'll leave you for some basic premises. And in my mind, that's one thing which I'm very conscious of. One, if you give a commitment to them, said unsaid, which you don't keep. Personal commitment. It may be whichever way, okay? Second, you believe that they believe and you believe and they feel that they're not valued, which means their requirements and their contribution in the organization is not perceived or it's not necessary in their minds. Third, they believe the system is unfair, which means, you know, other people are more fair in the system than what they are. As long as they're conscious of all these three things, I don't think it's very difficult to, you know, not keep people. And fourth, you have to be sensitive. You know, if you see a guy and you've seen him last many days, many months, you know intuitively there's something bothering him. And if something bothers him, then it's necessary to call that person and say, hey, you're not looking right, what's going on? And spend the time at that point of time. So it's, you know, it's common sense.
It sounds okay, I guess, and it works fine when you're a small organization. But when you've grown big, I mean, like Microland has, and especially in the growth that you've seen in the last 2 or 3 years, new companies, how do you institutionalize a system like this?
I guess the system works with each manager or each person taking care of the people who report into him. So therefore, my responsibility is very simple. The people who report into me, I have to be sensitive to what their needs are and what the expectations are. I'm hoping by virtue of doing that with them and spending a little time, they're as sensitive to their people and vice versa. You can't do it across the organization. But having said that, you know, you have to be sensitive that if when you walk in the corridor, you meet a guy in India.com, for example, you have a small conversation, and you get the pulse in a few minutes, whether it's going right or not going right. And, you know, normally I just ask a question, are you enjoying yourself? And the nature of the response, spontaneously, yes, maybe, you know the answer of that individual, and then you can probe further.
So what do you do? For instance, the individual is unhappy because the organization doesn't seem to be going anywhere, or environmental pressures, external pressures. What is your next step?
I think two elements. If the organization is going through a tight period in its cycle, it's imperative, starting from me as the chairman of this company and the CEO, to call all the employees and share them where you are. Because, you know, you can't bullshit with employees. They're smart enough. They can understand the issue.
Especially in this
business. Yeah, they're smart enough. So the essence is to share, this is where we are, this is the premise that we made, and this is what I changed. And therefore, this is what we are going through. This is what we are planning to do. It's not necessary enough to say, you know, we are going through a bad time, you know, so please bear with us. It's important for them to have confidence in the leadership to say that this management has the ability to take them to the next level. And then share what we're trying to do. And say, while we are moving from A to B, this is what we expect to achieve. These are the issues that we need, and this is what we need expect from them. So in my mind, communication is an integral part with a clarity of direction. That each employee wants to know that his company is going somewhere.
But what do you do when, you know, especially in a smaller organization, you know, smaller groups of people, individuals, how do you handle that?
No, I think the essence is very simple. If you know there's an individual in the organization who appears unhappy, it's imperative that you ensure that his boss spends time with him to understand his issues and tries help walk him through the issues. It may be about his role responsibility, it may be something at home, it may be some personal thing that he's going through, it may be his boss, you know, he's not getting along with his boss. So if you find that out, it's imperative that you try and take corrective actions and, you know, help that person to go through. And once you've done that, do something else a week later to ensure that's instead, hey, is that been fixed, are you okay now? So that follow-up has to be there to ensure that, you know, that person feels
Have you ever had to sack people or lay off people?
That's part of any job. You know, you sack people for two reasons. You sack people when, you know, when they don't perform. You sack people when some of the things that you want to do, you may not want to do to go forward. It's not, and let me restate that. The issue of having people leave the organization is not why, it's how you handle the process. So, you know, if any reason the guy is not performing, it's imperative that you counsel him, help him, you know, understand his issues, help him be successful outside, because the last thing you want to do is someone who worked for you is struggling on the roads, not finding a job. And in my mind, they are also future ambassadors, because tomorrow they can come back. The role may not have fitted him, the environment may not be suited, but there's always a potential that he can come back tomorrow. So we, you know, we're very conscious of the fact that people who lead the organization are your ambassadors, and we have to do many things and be gracious to make them successful.
Yeah. Finally, Pradeep, are you going to come back to your roots, I mean, in the next year, in terms of, I mean, the kind of business that you were doing some years ago?
Yeah, I guess, you know, if I look at where our focus next year is in the year 2001, certainly we want to re-own the space that we had created since 89 to 98 in the networking services space. Certainly we want to end of next year be one of the, and we could be, the one of the largest diversified technology services company under various cuts. And in my mind, you'll see us doing many more interesting things in the coming year.
Pradeep Kaur, thank you very much for joining us on Managing India.
Thank you very much.
That's all we have in Managing India tonight. We'll be back next week. Thanks for watching.
Managing India. Brought to you by Raymond for the special occasion called Life, ICICI Group, safer, simpler, smarter, and Ernst & Young from Ford to Finish.